very good morning. You're watching Rajya Sabha Television. I'm Smriti Rastogi with Breakfast News. Let's begin the bulletin with the top headlines of this morning. Narendra Modi urges stakeholders to find quick solution to Rohingya crisis. India and Myanmar sign 11 agreements after PM's meet with Aung San Suu Kyi. India must be prepared for two-front war, says Army Chief. Says China has begun flexing its muscles. No scope for reconciliation with Pakistan. Niti Aayog forms task force to push exports, create jobs. 15-member task force to submit report by November this year. US draft resolution at UNSC seeks oil embargo on North Korea. Assets freeze of Kim Jong-un. President Donald Trump says military action not its first choice. And Hurricane Irma batters Northern Caribbean Islands. Death reported as strongest ever Category 5 storm recorded in Atlantic, batters Antigua and Barbuda. It's the third and final day of Prime Minister Narendra Modi's first bilateral visit to Myanmar. The Prime Minister visited 2,500 years old Shwedagon Pagoda in Yangon, which is believed to contain the relics of Buddha. The PM is visiting Aung San Suu Kyi Museum and the Martyrs Mausoleum. The Prime Minister will visit the mausoleum of Mughal Emperor Bahadur Shah Zafar in Yangon. He will also visit the Kali Temple in downtown Yangon and offer prayers there. Security has been beefed up around the area. Prime Minister Narendra Modi met Myanmar State Councillor Aung San Suu Kyi in Nay Pai Taw on Wednesday. The two leaders discussed ways to further strengthen bilateral relations between India and Myanmar and signed 11 agreements. They also vowed to combat terror and boost security cooperation. Prime Minister Modi also addressed the situation in Myanmar's Rakhine, where a crackdown on Rohingya Muslims has sparked an enormous refugee crisis, drawing huge international condemnation for Nobel laureate Suu Kyi.
On his first bilateral visit to Myanmar, Prime Minister Narendra Modi urged all stakeholders to find a quick solution to the humanitarian crisis sparked by the Rohingya exodus. In a joint statement with State Councillor Aung San Suu Kyi, Modi said India understands Myanmar's problems.
जिन चुनौतियों को आप मुकाबला कर रही हैं, हम उन्हें पूरी तरह समझते हैं। रखाइन स्टेट में चरमपंथी हिंसा के चलते खासकर सिक्योरिटी फोर्सेस और मासूम जीवन की हानि को लेकर आपकी चिंताओं के हम भागीदार हैं, चाहे some rumors. वो बड़ी शांति प्रक्रिया हो या किसी विशेष मुद्दे को सुलझाने की बात, हम आशा करते हैं कि सभी स्टेक होल्डर्स मिलकर ऐसा हल निकालने की दिशा में काम कर सकते हैं, जिससे म्यांमार की एकता और भौगोलिक अखंडता का सम्मान करते हुए सभी के लिए शांति, न्याय, सम्मान और लोकतांत्रिक मूल्य सुनिश्चित होंगे।
The Prime Minister said that deepening the relationship with Myanmar is a priority for India. He also emphasized scaling up the security cooperation between the two countries. Suu Kyi thanked Prime Minister Modi for taking a strong stand on the terror threat faced by Myanmar recently.
I'd like to thank India particularly for the strong stand that it has taken. With regard to the terrorist threat that came to our country a couple of weeks ago. And we believe that together we can work to make sure that terrorism is not allowed to take root on our soil or on the soil of our neighboring countries.
India and Myanmar signed 11 agreements in areas like maritime security, strengthening democratic institutions, health and information technology. Modi also announced that India will grant gratis visa to visiting Myanmar citizens, along with the release of 40 Myanmari citizens currently lodged in Indian jails. Aklesh Suman's report for Rajya Sabha TV.
And Prime Minister Narendra Modi justified demonetization as he addressed the Indian diaspora in Yangon, saying his government was not afraid of taking big and tough decisions in the interest of the country. He also said that his government could take such decisions because it considers the country bigger than politics. He also talked about surgical strikes in POK last year and the GST as the other big and tough decisions taken by his three-year-old government. Referring to the note ban, the Prime Minister said the step was taken to curb black money and that it had helped identify lakhs of people who had crores of rupees in bank accounts but never paid income tax.
इस सरकार ने देश के हित में हर फैसला बिना किसी डर या संकोच से लिया है। जब अर्थव्यवस्था और उसको काले धन और भ्रष्टाचार से मुक्ति दिलाने के लिए कड़ा फैसला लेने की आवश्यकता हुई तो 1000 और 500 रुपये के नोट बंद करने का फैसला भी हम ले पाए। मुट्ठी भर कुछ लोगों के भ्रष्टाचार की कीमत अब देश के 125 करोड़ लोग उठा रहे थे, ये हमें मंजूर नहीं है।
An external affairs minister, Sushma Swaraj, has invited Russian entrepreneurs to invest in India, saying India is doing all to create ease of business. Sushma also met her Russian counterpart, Sergei Lavrov, on Wednesday and said that India-Russia friendship is rock solid.
External affairs minister Sushma Swaraj has invited Russian firms to invest in India in the flagship schemes initiated by Prime Minister Narendra Modi. Addressing the Indian and Russian officials and delegates at the reception hosted by Indian Ambassador to Russia, Pankaj Saran, Sushma Swaraj assured the entrepreneurs of ease of doing business.
प्रधानमंत्री मोदी के नेतृत्व में जो विकास का काम हो रहा है उसमें जो फ्लैगशिप प्रोग्राम्स केवल अगर मैं गिनाऊं तो फ्लैगशिप प्रोग्राम्स में मेक इन इंडिया, स्किल इंडिया, डिजिटल इंडिया, क्लीन इंडिया, स्टार्टअप इंडिया, स्टैंड अप इंडिया, इतने ज्यादा कार्यक्रम शुरू हुए हैं जिस सब में रूस के लोग आकर के अपना निवेश कर सकते हैं और आपके लिए बिजनेस हल्का हो जाए, आसान हो जाए। इसके लिए जो बोझ डला हुआ था कानूनों का, हजारों हजार कानून हमने समाप्त कर दिए जो टोटली आउटडेटेड थे, इररिलेवेंट थे, अप्रासंगिक थे।
Speaking at the India-Russia Business Dialogue at the Eastern Economic Forum, Sushma Swaraj called on Russian entrepreneurs to work with their Indian counterparts to develop a supply and manufacturing chain to help generate employment in the two countries. She also sought investment from the business community in Russia to help the two countries achieve the $30 billion bilateral trade target by 2025.
भारत और रूस दोनों के उद्यमी संयुक्त उद्यम लगा सकते हैं और आपूर्ति एवं उत्पादन श्रृंखला विकसित सकते हैं, जिससे एक दूसरे के देश में रोजगार का सृजन होगा और खुशहाली आएगी।
Earlier on Wednesday, the External Affairs Minister also held bilateral talks with Russia's Deputy Prime Minister Yuri Trutnev and her Russian counterpart Sergei Lavrov on the sidelines of the forum. In the meeting, Sushma Swaraj said that ties between the two nations were rock solid. Issues of trade and investment and defense cooperation were discussed in the meetings. Sushma Swaraj's visit to Russia comes just days after a meeting between Prime Minister Narendra Modi and Russian President Vladimir Putin in China's Xiamen city on the sidelines of BRICS summit. Bureau report, Rajya Sabha TV.
And several dignitaries called on Vice President M. Venkaya Naidu on Wednesday. The president of World Food Prize Foundation, Kenneth M. Queen, renowned Indian geneticist Professor M. S. Swaminathan, and other delegates of Indian Council of Food and Agriculture, led by M. J. Khan, called on the Vice President M. Venkaya Naidu at his residence. The Chief Minister of Manipur, Biren Singh, also met the Vice President M. Venkaya Naidu on Wednesday. The Union Minister of State for Housing and Urban Affairs, Hardeep Singh Puri, was also among those who called on the Vice President on Wednesday. On Wednesday, Vice President M. Venkaiah Naidu met the two newly appointed Ministers of State, Satyapal Singh for HRD and Giriraj Singh, MOS, for micro, small and medium enterprises in the national capital. This was the first meet with Vice President M. Venkaiah Naidu after the recent cabinet reshuffle. On to some more news. Niti Aayog has constituted an expert task force to give a major thrust to job creation by enhancing India's exports. The task force will be headed by Niti Aayog Vice Chairman Dr. Rajiv Kumar. The Niti Aayog said that a majority of workers are still employed in low productivity, low wage jobs in small, micro and own account enterprises. The policy think tank said that an urgent and sustained expansion of the organized sector is essential to address India's unemployment issues. The panel will give its recommendations and propose a comprehensive plan of action to generate employment and alleviate underemployment. The task force will submit its report by November 2017. Meanwhile, seven coaches of the Jabalpur-bound Shakti Punj Express derailed today in Sonbhadra district of Uttar Pradesh. The Shakti Punj Express coaches went off the rails near Orwa in UP at around 6:25 a.m. The train was on its way to Jabalpur from Howrah. No casualties or injuries have been reported so far. The passengers from the derailed coaches were shifted to the remaining coaches and the train left for the destination by 7:28 a.m. The train was running at a speed of about 40 kilometers per hour, which officials say prevented any injuries when the incident occurred. This is the third such derailment in the state in less than a month.
किसी के भी कैजुअल्टी कोई नहीं हुई है, किसी की इंजरीज नहीं हुई हैं, सभी यात्री सुरक्षित हैं, ऑल आर सेफ, कोई डेथ की खबर नहीं है, कोई घायल होने की खबर नहीं है, ऑल आर सेफ. और माननीय रेल मंत्री श्री पीयूष गोयल जी भी जो है स्थिति पे नजर रखे हुए हैं. उन्होंने त्वरित एक्शन के लिए रेलवे प्रशासन को निर्देश दिए हैं. सभी मुसाफिरों को निकाल भी लिया है. अब एक्सीडेंट साइट पे कोई स्ट्रैंडेड पैसेंजर्स भी नहीं है.
The cold-blooded murder of a senior journalist and activist Gauri Lankesh in Bengaluru has left many shocked. Journalists and politicians across the country condemned her murder. Home Minister Rajnath Singh has sought a report from the Karnataka government seeking details about the murder. The state government has set up a 21-member SIT to probe her death.
The murder of senior journalist Gauri Lankesh sparked protests in many cities. The editor of Kannada Weekly Gauri Lankesh Patrike was shot dead by unidentified assailants outside her residence in Bengaluru on Tuesday night. Police suspect that at least three people were involved. Friends and well-wishers paid last respects to the journalist. Her family expressed confidence that the culprits will be traced.
To us, that there is threats, this is some rumours. There was no threats to her. Of course, she was a firebrand journalist. She was an aggressive journalist. The CCTV has captured completely of what has happened and the investigation has to take place, and I'm requesting the police that in front of me or my mother, they have to open the CCTV.
The Home Ministry also sought a report from the Karnataka government on the killing. Chief Minister Siddaramaiah announced a 21-member special investigation team to probe the killing. Karnataka IGP Intelligence will head the team.
We please constitute a SIT, Special Investigation Team, headed by a senior officer, IG level officer, and also other officers, whosoever he wants, and that is going to be constituted immediately, and they will take up the investigation very seriously.
Politicians expressed shock and anger at the cold-blooded murder. Congress President Sonia Gandhi condemned the murder, while left parties demanded that the state government should soon identify and arrest the culprits. West Bengal Chief Minister Mamata Banerjee termed the killing sad and very alarming. She took part in a candlelight march in Kolkata to protest the killing and sought justice for the slain journalist. Union Minister Nitin Gadkari dismissed Congress Vice President Rahul Gandhi's allegations on the matter.
ये बेबुनियाद और झूठा आरोप है. हमारा गौरी लंकेश के इस घटना के साथ भारतीय जनता पार्टी का, भारत सरकार का, हमारे किसी संगठन का कोई संबंध नहीं है. हम इसका निषेध करते हैं और मैं ये मानता हूं कि कर्नाटक में कानून व्यवस्था मेंटेन करने की जिम्मेदारी कर्नाटक सरकार की है. कर्नाटक की सरकार कांग्रेस की है.
I spoke to the Chief Minister and I mentioned to him that it's very important that the people who have done this are got to, are punished, are caught and punished.
यह अत्यंत घृणास्पद और निंदनीय कृत्य है, किसने भी किया हो, और उसको कड़ी से कड़ी सजा होनी चाहिए.
Strongly condemn this brutal, this cowardly murder, assassination, and the politics behind it, the environment and the atmosphere being created in this country.
Union Minister Ravi Shankar Prasad hit out at those targeting Gauri Lankesh even after her killing. In a series of tweets, he said, "I strongly condemn and deplore the messages on social media expressing happiness on the dastardly murder of Gauri Lankesh." Various media bodies, including the Delhi Press Club, organized protests across the country. Protests were also held in Coimbatore, Chennai, Mumbai, Bhubaneswar, among other cities. The Editors Guild of India strongly condemned the murder of Lankesh and called for a judicial probe. The Broadcast Editors Association wanted the government to act promptly in identifying the culprits.
A very sad day for Indian democracy as well as for the freedom of press. A journalist, and particularly women journalists, who took all the trouble to expose whatever the wrongdoings was happening in the country, and she would be shot dead like that. That we cannot, as a journalist, we cannot accept that.
While I express my solidarity with journalist fraternity, as a citizen, I appeal through you, the people of India, all secular democratic forces, to stand up and challenge this threat from fascist forces.
55-year-old Lankesh was the daughter of famous poet-turned-journalist P. Lankesh. She wrote in support of rehabilitating Naxalites while voicing opposition against divisive politics. She was laid to rest with police honours at a ceremony attended by Karnataka Chief Minister, among others. Bureau Report, Rajya Sabha TV.
And with that, time for a very short break. More news and updates on the other side. Stay with us.
Harappan sites are a treasure trove of sophisticated pottery. These creations show tremendous advances by the potter's weave. Creations like the perforated jar, the copper axe, the chisel and knives astound even present-day archaeologists. Figurines depicting yoga poses, chess pieces display a complexity unsurpassed even by later-day civilizations, all of which make the Harappan civilization truly unique.
Thanks for being with us. Sweeping down on few traders and alleged hawala dealers, the NIA on Wednesday carried out searches at 27 places in various parts of Kashmir Valley and Delhi. The agency seized nearly 2.20 crore rupees in cash and raids relating to the probe into the terror funding activities in the state. During the operations, houses and business establishments of those suspected of channelizing funds to fuel secessionist and anti-India activities were searched. Various digital devices, including laptops, mobile phones and hard drives, have also been seized during the searches. The raids come a day after the NIA arrested two persons, including a freelance photojournalist, who allegedly indulged in stone pelting and mobilizing support against the security personnel through social media. These raids and arrest by the NIA is the part of investigation in a case in which a leader of the Pakistan-based Jamaat-ul-Dawah and banned terrorist outfit Lashkar-e-Taiba, Hafiz Saeed, was named as an accused. Army Chief General Bipin Rawat on Wednesday said that country should be prepared for a two-front war. Rawat insisted that China has started flexing its muscles, while there seems to be no scope for reconciliation with Pakistan, whose military and polity saw an adversary in India. Referring to the 73-day-long Doklam standoff, the Army Chief warned that situation could gradually snowball into a larger conflict on the northern border. He said there is a possibility that these conflicts could be limited in space and time or can expand into an all-out war along the entire frontier, with Pakistan taking advantage of the situation. The comments by General Rawat came after Prime Minister Narendra Modi and Chinese President Xi Jinping agreed on a forward-looking approach to Sino-India ties, putting behind the Doklam standoff. The Army Chief was speaking at a seminar organized by the Center for Land Warfare Studies. On to some more news. The United States has said that Pakistan must change its approach towards terror groups operating from its soil and take decisive action against them. The statement was in response to a question on BRICS statement that named Pakistan-based Lashkar-e-Taiba and Jaish-e-Mohammed among the terror groups and create problem in the region. For the first time, BRICS summit in their joint declaration named Pakistan-based terror group as a concern for the regional security and called an action against them. Pakistan has denied allegations that it harbors these groups. On to international news, the U.S. is seeking to slap an oil embargo on North Korea. It also seeks to freeze the assets of leader Kim Jong-un in response to Pyongyang's sixth and most powerful nuclear test. A U.S. drafted resolution has been circulated at the UN Security Council. President Donald Trump called on Chinese President Xi Jinping and said that military option against the North was not the first choice.
The US has asked the UN Security Council to slap an oil embargo on North Korea and freeze the assets of leader Kim Jong-un. A U.S.-drafted resolution at the UNSC also called for banning textile exports and ending payments made to North Korean laborers sent abroad. This is in response to Pyongyang's sixth and most powerful nuclear test and is aimed at further depriving the regime of revenue to pursue its military programs. The United States circulated the proposed resolution to the 14 other council members. The U.S. presented the new raft of measures after President Donald Trump spoke on phone with his Chinese counterpart Xi Jinping and told him that military action against North Korea was not his first choice.
We're going to see what happens. We'll see what happens. Certainly that's not a first choice, but we will see what happens. Thank you very much.
The U.S. has urged China, which is the North's main trading partner, to put more pressure on Pyongyang to limit its controversial missile program. President Xi has told Trump that China is firm on solving the Korean Peninsula nuclear issue through talks and peaceful means. On the other hand, Russian President Vladimir Putin met his South Korean counterpart Moon Jae-in on the sidelines of a conference on economic development of Russia's Far East in Vladivostok. While Putin called for talks with North Korea, Moon called for Moscow to support stronger sanctions against Pyongyang.
이 지역이 당면한 가장 시급하고 중대한 도전인 북한 핵미사일 문제를 조속히 해결하는 것이 무엇보다 중요하다는데 의견을 같이 하였습니다. 저와 푸틴 대통령은 북한이 추구하는 핵 미사일 개발은 잘못된 길이며
одними лишь санкциями и давлением невозможно. Не стоит поддаваться эмоциям и загонять Северную Корею в угол. Сейчас как никогда всем необходимо проявить хладнокровие и избегать шагов, ведущих к эскалации напряженности.
Russia also informed that its delegation may meet with a delegation from North Korea on sidelines of the economic forum in Vladivostok this week.
Как я понимаю, делегация Корейской Народно-Демократической Республики на Восточном экономическом форуме состоит из представителей экономического блока правительства КНДР. У нас здесь тоже есть представители экономических министерств и ведомств. Так что, думаю, по линии профильных структур двух стран контакты состоят.
Japanese Prime Minister Shinzo Abe, who arrived for the forum, said North Korea has no bright future if it continues on its current path.
政策を進めていくと今の道を進んでいくんであれば未来はない明るい未来はないということを理解させ現在の政策を変えさせなければなりません。そのためにも日露で
North Korea on Sunday triggered global alarm when it detonated what it described as a hydrogen bomb designed for a long-range missile. The detonation was followed by signs that Pyongyang was preparing a new missile launch. Bureau Report, Rajya Sabha TV.
Deaths have been reported as Hurricane Irma battered Northern Caribbean islands on Wednesday. Islands of Antigua, Barbuda, St. Martin and St. Barts felt the fury of the Category 5 storm, one of the strongest ever recorded in Atlantic. Later today, the Eye of Irma will pass just north of Puerto Rico, where evacuations are underway. Thereafter, a storm will graze by the Dominican Republic, Turks and Caicos, and the southeastern Bahamas. All these islands can expect stormy winds, heavy rainfall, and coastal storm surge.
Widespread damage in northern Caribbean islands after Hurricane Irma blasted through, packing devastating winds and rain. Irma's core has a maximum sustained winds of 295 km per hour, well above the threshold of a Category 5 storm. Antigua and Barbuda have been affected, with the storm damaging more than 90% of the buildings here. Prime Minister Gaston Brown said after visiting the island that it was a total devastation. One fatality, an infant, has been confirmed, and there is currently no water or phone service for residents. The hurricane has also caused considerable damage on French island territories in the Caribbean. At least two persons died and two others were seriously injured on St. Barts and St. Martin. Irma destroyed government buildings, tore roofs from houses, and left the islands without power or communications. Officials say some of the strongest buildings on the island have been destroyed, boding ill for weaker structures on St. Martin. French president says the impact of Irma would be hard and cruel.
Nous venons ainsi de faire un point très détaillé sur la situation après le cyclone qui, durant la journée, a profondément attaqué, puisque c'est bien le terme qui convient, ces deux îles.
The storm also hit Antigua, a British overseas territory in the Caribbean. British government says it is in touch with the overseas territories caught up in Irma and was doing everything to help those affected. The Category 5 hurricane, the highest possible level, is now passing over the northern Virgin Islands. It is also forecast to pass near Puerto Rico and then near Dominican Republic on Thursday. U.S. President Donald Trump has declared a state of emergency for Florida, Puerto Rico, and the U.S. Virgin Islands, mobilizing federal disaster relief efforts.
We've had more than 4,000 volunteers sign up in less than 24 hours. This includes more than 700 state employees. This is outstanding, but we still need more. We need about 17,000 volunteers statewide. The Red Cross is sending 1,000 volunteers to Florida.
Thousands of people have been evacuated from at-risk areas across the Caribbean. Residents have flocked to shops for food, water, and emergency supplies, and airports have been closed on several islands which are popular holiday destinations. Forecasters warn that Irma's likely path will be near the Turks and Caicos Islands thereafter and southeastern Bahamas on Friday, and that the destruction could be devastating. In the Bahamas, emergency evacuations have been ordered for six southern islands. Bureau report, Rajya Sabha TV.
On to sports news, India defeats Sri Lanka by 7 wickets in the lone T20 international match at Colombo's R. Premadasa Stadium on Wednesday. Chasing 171 runs for victory, India hit on 119 runs second wicket stand between Kohli and Manish Pandey to achieve their target with 4 balls to spare. Kohli has been adjudged as the man of the match. For Sri Lanka, E. Munavira was the top scorer with 53 runs. The visitors remain unbeaten in their 9 matches against Sri Lanka. And ace tennis player Rafael Nadal and Coco Vandeweghe have reached the semifinals of the ongoing US Open Tennis Championship at Flushing Meadows in New York. Top-seeded Nadal beat Russian Andrei Rublev 6-1, 6-2, 6-2. While number 53 Rublev struggled to find his touch as he committed 43 unforced errors during the test. Nadal will now face Juan Martin Del Potro or Roger Federer on Friday. In another match, American Coco Vandeweghe defeated world number one Carolina Pliskova 7-6, 6-3. Vandeweghe became the third American to seal a women's semi-final spot. Vandeweghe will now face the winner of the match between compatriot Madison Keys and Estonian Kanepi. And that's all we have for you in this edition of Breakfast News. Keep watching Rajya Sabha Television.